बड़ी। व्हाट इज इट अबाउट भगवत गीता दैट यू नो दैट ब्रिंग्स अ नाइस फीलिंग विद इन अस। सी अंडरस्टैंड वन और टू थिंग्स वेरी क्लियरली। वेर एवर यू गो एज वॉट एवर स्टूडेंट ऑफ एनी स्पिरिचुअल प्लेस, थ्री थिंग्स यू हैव टू स्टडी। वन इज भगवत गीता, वन इज उपनिषद्स, एंड द थर्ड इज ब्रह्म सूत्रस। ओके, सो इट्स कॉल्ड प्रस्थान त्रया। सो बिगिनिंग थ्री, बेसिकली प्रस्थान त्रया, एंड चैप्टर 14 इज समथिंग टू डू विद द थ्री। इट इज अंडरस्टैंड द थ्री गुणास। ओके, वॉट आर दीज गुणास वील अंडरस्टैंड स्लोली, बट फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वॉट इज इट अबाउट भगवद गीता एंड वी नीड टू रिवाइव अगेन बिकॉज वी इन बिटवीन वी टेक अ ब्रेक एंड समटाइम्स वी रीड अदर स्क्रिप्चर्स एंड अदर थिंग्स एंड समवेयर वी लूज ट्रैक ऑफ लॉर्ड कृष्णा। सो आई थॉट विल ब्रिंग हिम बैक ऑन द सीन जस्ट फॉर अ रिमाइंडर फॉर पीपल हु फॉरगेट। Because see, as soon as we start going into the Upanishads, Upanishads are straight statements. Okay, all Upanishads. What do they say? Tattvamasi. What do they say? Aham Brahmasmi. What they say? I am Atman Brahman. Prajnanam Brahma. These are all Mahavakyas. And these Mahavakyas, what are these? These are direct statements from the rishis, from the seers for us. To do what? To know who we are. So it deals with the ultimate, you could say. It deals with, you know, who you are. It deals with self-inquiry. And it's beautiful because we feel, oh, wow. That's who I am. And you know, we start going into that track of understanding. I am the Bhagwan, I am the self, I am only that. And it's very beautiful. But somewhere it's nice, it's practical also because it's dealing with the self. But we forget that we have been conditioned and trained to think and believe that we are the body. Okay, that I am the body, I am the mind, I am all of this. Whatever I do, I do. You know, I got angry, I got irritated. And everywhere I'm constantly, each of us is constantly associating with the body and with the mind and the whole paraphernalia, the intellect. You know, I'm intelligent, that one is dumb. You know, stuff like that. So what does all this mean? This clearly, you know, bifurcates the thing that I am Atman Brahman. Oh yeah, but right now I have to deal with this body mind complex. So Swami Chinmayananda used to say BMI, you know, body mind intellect identity, however you understand it. So basically, it is we have to constantly deal in this world that we see, okay, with the body, with the mind, with the intellect, and the ego. So even if I understand, I am Atman Brahman, Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi, I still have to deal with this fellow. There is no escape, right? The minute I am out of the session, I am into this only. Directly, and even during the sessions, sometimes, even during the meditations. So, this one is not going to leave me at any point of time. So, then there is no point in disassociating with it just because I realize I am Atman Brahman. If you look at the rishis, if you look at the swamis, if you look at everybody, whoever you feel is, you know, in a good state, near realization, almost realized, fully realized, Swami, you know, or Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, you know, his favorite was Bhagavad Gita. His favorite was Bhagavad Gita. If you look at Sri Sri Ravi Shankar now, he will usually quote the Bhagavad Gita. He never quotes the Upanishads directly in public. He will always quote the Bhagavad Gita. But look at current day gurus, look at the previous gurus, masters. Everybody quotes from the Bhagavad Gita. Why? It is the most practical handbook that all of us should possess at all points of time. So all those who are working or in any profession or teaching or doing whatever you are doing, make sure if you have a desk, keep the Bhagavad Gita right in front of you. We really feel that, oh, why? In a small handbook, I always show this book. This is so handy that it can fit into a small purse. All shlokas are there with the English translation. So just in any situation, just open it and read whatever comes to you. It's that handy, that handy. But somewhere we feel, oh no, we understand a few shlokas here and there, and we feel, okay, but I want to know more. Even the more that we want to know is hidden in this book. Why it is most practical? Because from a small child, just a baby like 5, 6, 7 years old, we can read the Bhagavad Gita, and a completely realized soul will also read the Gita. That is the beauty of Bhagavad Gita. So at no point, I know people who say that, oh, Bhagavad Gita, let it be, I am reading Ashtavakra. Okay? So Ashtavakra, or I am reading Yoga Vashishta, or I am reading Avadhuta Gita. So this is like ultimate knowledge, There is nothing, no tension. I am only that. Bas khatam, baat khatam. Let's forget about everything else. Were it that easy? It's not easy. Ashtavakra says, Ashtavakra Gita is a conversation between two realized people. And there is Sage Janaka and there is Ashtavakra. King Janaka and Sage Ashtavakra, both are realized. Both know. So then what do we do? We understand the knowledge, we enjoy it, we experience it, we meditate upon it. It's not less. But then I have to deal with my spouse, I have to deal with my family, I have to deal with my clients, I have to deal with my patients, I have to deal with hundreds of people. What to do with Ashtavakra? Ashtavakra is for self, meditation of the self. But Bhagavad Gita is handbook. It's a guide. I have to deal with all this. I have to deal with my mind. Oh my God. Pick the Gita. The mind is the biggest challenge for us. Even for those who are near realization or with the master, we start undermining the Gita as soon as we get a bigger scripture. Bigger in the sense that speaks of the self, that speaks of the pure consciousness, that speaks of you, the consciousness, and stuff like that. Say, bas, now I have realized. And Bhagavad Gita is for beginners. See, Bhagavad Gita is versatile. It is used for beginners and for advanced also. It depends on who the seeker is. Depends on what consciousness level the seeker is, the Bhagavad Gita can be exposed. Because Lord Krishna has given the ultimate knowledge that could be given in any Ashtavakra or any Avadhut Gita or any scripture for that matter in chapter 13. It's no less. It's no less. So then it's only that we don't understand. We feel it's a beginner's diary. It's a lifetime, you could call it as a gift that you carry with yourself, which you gift yourself. So, with lot of reverence to the scripture, lot of trust on what was said in the Bhagavad Gita, we have to proceed. Whatever else we are studying, is a separate study, and this is a practical study, and this chapter is a complete practical guide to break, to understand, to dissect, to detect, to observe what the antahkarana, the mana, buddhi, chitta, ahankara, which is our biggest challenge today. The subtle body is our biggest challenge. How to deal with it? What is happening in it? Who put it in? How to remove it? Can I remove it? Oh, should I change it? What should I do with this? How do I manage this? All this is kind of brought together in this chapter. So, 14th chapter is absolutely practical. Whereas, chapter 13 was highest knowledge we could receive. Chapter 12, highest devotion one can imagine. Chapter 11, the highest wonder one can feel. Vishwarupa Darshan. Chapter 10, prep for chapter 11. Vibhuti Yoga. Similarly, the remaining chapter. See, if you understand how Bhagavad Gita is led by Lord Krishna, one by one by one, it's like a beautiful chain, you know. One link to the other, one link to the other. And the deeper we go, each time it always unravels something new for us, each of us, depending on where you are. So always keep the Bhagavad Gita with you and revisit it n number of times. And as many times as you can. And never feel it is any less than any other scripture on this planet. It is. If you look into Ashtavakra, if you look into Yoga Vaishishtha, if you look into everywhere they are quoting this, our Bhagavad Gita. Honestly, it's very close to my heart also. Like if somebody comes up and says that I don't like Bhagavad Gita, I would be like, okay, enjoy yourself because you're going to be in a mess. Without the Bhagavad Gita and holding all the rest of the scriptures, without Gita, okay? Without Bhagavad Gita, having mastered 10 big, great, beautiful scriptures, person is in a mess. This I can stamp and sign and give it to you. You can check with anybody. If they have not dived deeper into the Bhagavad Gita and taken up other studies, they are going to be in a mess, whoever it is. However, you know, like an old sadhak also, like old in the sense, not age-wise, a very senior sadhak rather, I should say. A senior seeker will be in a mess without the Bhagavad Gita. And once they are in a, you know, practical mess, vasanas are rising, don't know what to do. I am Atma Brahma, I am Brahmasmi, kya karenge leke? What are we going to do with it? My vasanas are rising. My desires are troubling me. I can't sleep at night. I can't deal with people. I feel jealous. I feel anger. What should I do? I'm a senior sadhak. Having understood all the major scriptures, without the Bhagavad Gita, I'm without limbs, I would say. Literally. So understand how beautiful this is. This is my perspective. Okay? My opinion, my perception. But I would tell each of you that read it, feel it, and experience it yourself. Only then you will see that everything is inside this. If you are into yoga, yogi, there is so much stuff in this. Chapter 6 is the epitome of yoga, literally. If you want to meditate, chapter 6. If you want to feel devotion, for the divine, chapter 12, 10, 11, 12. If you want core knowledge, chapter 7, chapter 9, chapter 13. The culmination of all this starts from now, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. But now, the most important thing that we need to deal with in our lives is being dealt with in chapter 14, and that is guna. Guna, Traya, Vibhaga, Yoga. Tra, three. First of all, Trayate is to sail over. ओके, फॉर टू सेल ओवर द संसार चक्रा ठाए थे तुम पास ओवर दिस चक्रा वी नीड द ट्री, वी आर स्टक इन द ट्री एंड वी हैव टू यू नो ट्रांसेंड द ट्री फॉर त्रायते टू मूव ऑन. वॉट इज दिस थ्री? देर इज ब्रह्मा विष्णु महेश, देर आर थ्री दोषास, देर आर थ्री गुणास. इफ यू लुक एट लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स इट विल बी थ्री, थ्री मूर्ति एवरीवेयर, देर विल बी अ ट्रायंगल. ओके, द ट्रायंगल बिकेम माई फेवरेट, दैट्स वाई इवन इन द निर्माणा लोगो आई यूज द ट्रायंगल, बिकॉज वी हैव टू ट्रांसेंड दैट थ्री. इफ आई डोंट कीप इट इन फ्रंट ऑफ माई आईज आई एम गोइंग टू मिस द बोट. सो द ट्रायंगल, द ट्राई इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. वी ऑल्सो हैव तिरंगा फॉर आवर इंडिया, नॉट फॉर द फन ऑफ इट ना. वाई तिरंगा, वाई नॉट चौरंगा और वॉट एवर अंगा? वाई वर थ्री डिसाइडेड एज द फ्लैग, कलर ऑफ द फ्लैग? द थ्री इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इन अंडरस्टैंडिंग लाइफ, मैनेजिंग लाइफ एंड डीलिंग विथ लाइफ टोटली एंड देन ट्रांसेंडिंग इट टू बिकम फ्री. आई कैन नॉट बिकम फ्री अंटिल इट्स लाइक आई एम डिसीज्ड, ओके, एंड आई वॉन्ट टू कम आउट ऑफ दिस, बट आई डोंट नो वॉट द डिसीज इज, आई डोंट नो वॉट इज माई मेलेडी, आई डोंट नो वॉट्स माई ट्रबल, बट आई वॉन्ट टू गेट आउट ऑफ दिस. एंड समबडी सेज नो नीड टू गेट आउट, इट्स ओके, डिसोसिएशन, डिटैचमेंट, यू आर देयर, यू आर परब्रह्म, फिनिश. नाउ विदाउट डिटेक्टिंग द डिसीज आई गॉट सम काइंड ऑफ अ सोल्यूशन विच इज ट्रू, बट इट्स ऑफ नो यूज टू मी. वाई? बिकॉज आई एम स्टिल स्टक इन दिस थ्री. ओके, सो व्हेन आई बिगेन दीज सेशंस आई थिंक अ कपल ऑफ इयर्स अगो, द फर्स्ट चैप्टर, द फर्स्ट कपल ऑफ सेशंस आई वॉज कॉन्स्टेंटली स्पीकिंग अबाउट दिस थ्री. आई हैड इन्फॉर्म्ड एवरीबडी दैट दिस इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट द थ्री, एंड आई हैड सेड दैट व्हेन वी रीच द 14th चैप्टर वी विल डील विथ इट प्रॉपरली. बट नाउ जस्ट फॉर अ क्विक रीकैप, इफ यू गो थ्रू द गीता, ऑल ऑफ दोज हु हैव द बुक इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू, चैप्टर 2.45, सेकेंड चैप्टर 45th श्लोक. यू हैव इट? वेरी गुड न्यूज, कैन यू रीड इट?
त्रैगुण्य विषया वेदा निस्त्रैगुण्यो भवार्जुना निर्द्वन्द्वो नित्य सत्त्वस्थो निर्योगक्षेम आत्मवान.
So it began in chapter 2. What began? This Triguna, this word began. So he was hinting, because it was all Sankhya and Buddhi and such yoga, he was explaining. Traigunya Vishaya Veda. Understand that this whole mess is because of the Triguna, and you have to become Nistraigunyo Bhava Arjuna. You have to become Nistraigunyo. Beyond the three gunas, you have to transcend the gunas. The message was already there. Then again, it came up in chapter 7.13, 7.14. There again, he gave the hint about the gunas. So he has been constantly, Krishna has been constantly reminding us what the gunas are, how important they are. Got it?
Yeah.
Tribir.
Yeah.
Yeah.
त्रिभिर्गुणमयैर्भावैर्एभिः सर्वम् इदम् जगत् मोहितम् नाभिजानाति मामेभ्यः परमव्ययम्.
14 also is there.
दैवीहेषा गुणमयी मम माया दुरत्यया मामेव ये प्रपद्यन्ते मायामेतां तरन्ति ते.
Taranti, to cross over, what do you need? Cross over what? Maya, what is this? Prakriti is what? Gunamaya. He says, this Gunamayi, what is this? This gunas are arising. And this is the challenge. This is the biggest challenge. Then, naturally, chapter 13th, 20th and 22nd shloka speak about guna again. And 27th also, we'll take all the three. 20, 22 and 27. Prakritim purusham chaiva.
Prakritim purusham chaiva. Vidyanadi ubhavapi. Vikaramscha gunamschaiva. Vidhi prakriti sambhavan.
Then next, purushaha prakriti stho.
Purushaha prakrito, sorry, prakritistho hi bhukte prakriti jan gunan karanam guna sangosya sadasadyoni janmasu.
Yavat sanjayate. Yavat sanjayate. 27th.
Yavat sanjayate kinchet satvam sthavara jangamam kshetra kshetrajna samyogat tadvidhi bharatarshabha.
Okay. Now the prakritim purusham chaiva. Understand, know this, that both are anadi. Okay? Anadi, ubhavapi, both are anadi. Anadi means beginningless. There is no beginning and end to this. Prakriti and Purusha have always been there. And vikaranscha gunanscha eva, and know this, that the vikara, the transformations that's happening in all of us and entire nature, and the gunas. Okay, where are these coming from? Sambhavan. Where are these arising from? Prakriti. Okay, so the transformation is due to the gunas. And what is this gunas? Gunas is nothing but prakriti. So this was already hinted in chapter 13. Then he says, Purusha prakriti stho. Okay, Purusha, the one, okay, seated in prakriti. And enjoying and suffering everything. Prakriti jan guna. Prakriti jan guna means prakriti ne janam diye hue gun. Prakriti has given birth to the gunas. Jan guna. Okay? And karanam guna sangyo. Why is Purusha stuck in prakriti? As per even Sankhya Yoga and the Yoga School. Purusha and Prakriti are stuck. Purusha is stuck with Prakriti. How does he get entangled? Karanam guna sango. Very clear, clear answers. Karanam guna sango got entangled, attached to the gunas. That's why Purusha got entangled with Prakriti. Because he misidentified. Okay? Due to the gunas. The gunas are the reason for all that we are facing, enjoying, suffering, everything today. So the gunas play a very major role. The three gunas. And in this chapter, we'll go into detail. 13.27 is an intro for chapter 14. Because he says, Yavat sanjayate kinchit. Satvam sthavaram jangamam kshetra kshetrajna sayoga tadviddhi bharatarshaba. Understand, okay? Just know, exact translation is whatever manifested moving or unmoving beings, okay? You see in this existence, oh best of the Bharata, know it to be a combination of the field of activities, kshetra, and the knower of the fields, field kshetrajna. But this is as per Sankhya. What does Vedanta say? Vedanta says, Kshetra, Kshetrajna, Parabrahman. Do not declare directly that it is only these two who are the reason. What we feel, Kshetra, the field of activities that we learnt in chapter 13, and of course the knower of the field, the Purusha, Prakriti and Purusha entangled together are the reason for the Jagata. Vedanta says surely, but there is a Parabrahman, Brahman, Parabrahman, Paramatma, the divine pure consciousness, plus these two of course. So these two are there for everything, but there is one who is still there above these two. That is Vedanta's view. Sankhya says, no, no, no. There is Purusha, there is Prakriti. And these two are the reason for the entire Jagata, which is also philosophy. If you follow Sankhya, you can go ahead with that. If you understand Vedanta, then understand that these two plus one. That one is most important. The rest two are just coming under that Parabrahman. Okay. So then to clear this confusion of Sankhya, Lord Krishna has begun with this 14th chapter. This is the introduction for chapter 14, technically. Why was chapter 14 introduced? Because of this. We have to also understand the Guna Sang. So now it was just hinted and left. Now we'll take it in detail in this chapter. That why is this Jagata? What is this world? Why we are facing misery? What are the reason for our sukha dukha and everything? So now there are certain questions, okay, that we have to format before we start the chapter. Okay, because we need the answers. And Krishna has not verbally put the questions. So what does the guru do? When the Shishya does not ask question, the guru only makes those questions. What to do? Because student may be not up to date, maybe little lazy, maybe into tamas, maybe little ignorant, maybe not wanting to do it. You know, there are lots of reasons we could explore on that. But the point is, we need to understand what are the questions. The questions are, which gunas has what type of attachment? Sango, sango is attachment. Which guna has what type of attachment? Like suppose Rajas guna is, how you can get attached to Rajas guna? How Rajas guna can make you attached? You know, both ways. So basic question is, which guna has what type of attachment? Okay. How many gunas are there and what are they? So we all know three gunas, and that is Rajas, Tamas, Sattva. But it will be mentioned by Shri Krishna also. How do gunas bind us? You know, guna also means thread. Guna means color. Guna means essence. Guna means flavor. Guna means quality, attribute. This is all guna. We can understand it differently. Okay? How do gunas bind us? How can, see, if something can bind us only with something like a thread. So that's why it's a thread also. How can one be freed of this binding of gunas? Okay, freedom from gunas. Freedom from bondage of gunas. Or the binding of gunas. How do we get that? It's not that Arjuna doesn't ask, but towards the fag end of the chapter, he does come up with some questions. Okay? Then, what are the traits of one who has been liberated of the gunas? Chapter 2, Arjuna has Sthita Prajnastha Ka Bhasha. Samadhis. He keeps asking certain questions. How does he walk? How does he talk? The one who is in Sthita Prajna, Samatvam. How does he eat? How does he stand? How does he do everything? Now also he will ask towards the end. But let's format the questions earlier itself, because the answers will be from the beginning, little, little, you know. The main answers are towards the end. So to explain all these things, what are the traits of one who has been liberated of the gunas, to explain all this, chapter 14 was spoken. Okay? Now, what is guna? We have to begin with that basic. Okay? Understand it as quality or essence or flavor. It has color zones. Like sattva is considered white, rajas is red, and tamas is black. So sattva is considered as purity, goodness, knowledge, etc. It will be translated. Rajas is action, activity, passion, so red. And tamas is darkness, ignorance, laziness, etc. Okay, so understand these gunas. Why this is the most practical chapter for us? What you need to do to understand this or to make use of this chapter is, as we speak every shloka and understand everything, every day sit with yourself for 10 minutes and check which guna is going where of mine. None of us can exist without the gunas. No body, mind, ego complex is possible without the gunas. Okay? So even if it is a guru and transcended technically, but until the body is going on, the gunas will be playing. Okay? It's not possible otherwise. So the gunas are constantly at play. They are like in a cyclical motion. Now sattva is there, rajastamas will fall back. Rajas will rise, sattva tamas. Tamas will rise, sattva rajas piche. It's like a cycle. And they are cycling continuously through the day. Early morning when you wake up and you feel bright and good, that is sattva. Late night when you are, dozing off, pure tamas. We all need it. Otherwise, we can't sleep. Rajas, full activity throughout the day. Observe yourself at what point of time which guna is dominating. Sometimes you'll react to a person. That time, understand that which guna was pushing from within. It will be Rajas. Okay, and followed by tamas, and sattva will be third. It's like our tridosha, vata, pitta, kapha. One goes wrong, the other two also fall down here and there. Similarly, the gunas, they are all. See, the point here is when nistrai gunyo bhava arjuna means in complete balance. All gunas in complete balance. That's where we need to reach. Okay. If you understand physics, it is neutron, electron, proton. Nothing else. I don't know how many years ago or centuries ago this was found. Neutron, proton, electron, the division and all this stuff. But our rishis found it ages ago, 5,000-6,000 years ago. They already knew about this. That's why we say whatever science finds today, happily go into any Veda, any Upanishad, and you'll find that already written. That is the strength of our scriptures. We need to feel, great and, feel happy from within that, oh, I'm part of this culture, I'm part of this. I have so much access to the ancient knowledge. There was no Google. There was nothing to, no scientist as such. The rishis were no less than scientists. Without a laboratory, with eyes closed, they declared that there are gunas, that one is doing this, one is doing this, one is doing this. And then we say, oh, physics has found that there is neutron, proton, electron, and there is photon, and there is whatever. It came much later. Now we can link it, and we got proof. For our Upanishad, the declaration that was made has now technical proof. So similarly, you understand that one of them will be moving, activity will be there, other will have potential, and third will be still. So understand the qualities of those three. Neutron, without them there is nothing. If you want to understand matter, you have to understand physics also, if biology also. If you understand biology, if you understand physics, you understand that okay, these three are in constant flux. Then you come back to the Gunas and say, Are, but Lord Krishna already told this. The Vedas already declared this. So then this is the strength of the seers. That's why we call them seers, rishis, who just sat in meditation and said, this. Very, very clearly. That if you see now how clearly it's been explained. See, what is guna? It is the qualities or essence or flavor, color, whatever you like. And see, another scientific way of understanding is the entire universe, or you could just understand it as one consciousness, okay? The one consciousness is one, operating through many, but one only. We can't say this consciousness is like that and that. No, all consciousness is one, similar, okay? Then all water is also one. All earth is also one. All air is also one, technically, right? So when I put one glass of, same glass of water in your stomach and in my stomach, there is a different reaction. Why? Consciousness, same. Matter, same. What is causing the vikaranshcha, gunanshcha eva? The transformation, the changes are happening due to the gunas. So whatever, same medicine, different constitution, different. Everything is different. Same thing is being spoken now, differently accumulated, depending on whether the mind is in a state of sattva, rajas, or tamas. It will be gathered. It will be absorbed. Same thing is being said. Same consciousness, same matter. But absorbed differently. This is because of the gunas. That's why this is the practical chapter. When people ask what to do practically, do this. Because sit with your gunas. See, it's what do you say? It's a personal observation that you will have to do. I can't look at you and say this person is in tamas and sattva. We can barely judge. So the point is, you sit with yourself and look at yourself and see, tamas is dominating today. Feeling too lazy to get out of bed also. I couldn't attend my class. What is dominating me? Tamas. I was restless. What is dominating me? Rajas. And don't worry, it keeps changing. It keeps changing throughout the day. But always there'll be one which is predominant in you. Just check which is it and try to transcend that. Okay? So this is a, see what you need to do. You need to observe. You need to detect. Okay? Diagnose, in the words of a doctor. You need to diagnose, you need to detect, and then you need to readjust. It's like the subtle body, the mana buddhi chitta ahankara is the subtle body, which I always call it as a program, individual program for each of us, which is different. Why? Each of you, okay, is a program. The subtle body is a program. Each program is different. Each subtle body is different. Your mana buddhi chitta ahankara is different. My mana buddhi chitta ahankara is different. Her, this is different. Why there are so much differences? It's because of, the reason for the differences is because of the gunas. The base reason is the gunas. So then what do? I look into my desires, my vasanas, my anger, my love, my hatred, and all these things. What do I do with this? I observe, I detect, and I readjust. I readjust. What do I readjust? What is the base of the program? Vasanas, samskaras, okay, impressions, whichever word you like. These are nothing but habitual tendencies. Okay, tendencies created by habit, by repeatedly doing something. This is our trouble. This is now ruling us today. Vasana. To come and attend the Bhagavad Gita session is also vasana. Not attending the Bhagavad Gita session is also vasana. I like milk is a vasana. I don't like milk is also vasana. I love chocolates, vasana. I hate chocolates, vasana. It's not like, oh, so much vasana, they're eating chocolate every day. Are the way you're speaking, that is also vasana. You have pure dislike for that item. It could be non-vegetarian. She full time they're eating non-veg. God knows what they are eating. Vasana. They are eating vasana. You pointing it out and being very effective about it. Vasana. Just look at your vasanas. It's not, oh, I have that one vasana, you know. I have to deal with that. No. There are sack load of seeds in it. Vasana. Now just observe. I love this vasana. I hate this vasana. I prefer this vasana. I don't like this vasana. If you make a list of your vasanas, you can buy a 200 pages diary. Simple. So that you don't fall short of pages. That's all. You could buy a bigger one if you want. But every day when you sit down, just enjoy. Don't be too harsh on yourself. Krishna doesn't believe on being very harsh and very rough and tough on yourself. Enjoy. Enjoy the journey. Why? I'm detecting my vasanas today. So I'm going to sit and just make a note. Oh, this came up. Very good. This came up. How long has been this going on? I think since I was 10 years old. Okay, write it. This is an age-old vasana. This seems to be coffee. I can't get up. I can't work without my tea or coffee. What is this? Tea vasana, coffee vasana. See, we are not judging good or bad. It's perfectly fine. Don't write good and bad. Just write, I have tea vasana, I have coffee vasana. So enjoy the vasana journey. Make a list. This is the major composition of our subtle body. This rules us, literally pushes us to do things. You know, I don't want to eat chocolate. I just went to the fridge actually to keep the curds inside. I saw that chocolate bar and I just put it in my mouth. It was lying open, you know, one piece was left. Why keep it inside? I just put it in my mouth. Vasana. Enjoy it. Enjoy it. Just, you know, I was putting the cashew nuts into the pulao. And two or three went inside also in my stomach. All this is fun. This is all vasana. And this is the most practical. Because you just observe how things are, you know, happening by themselves. The vasana is making us do and I can't do anything. Now comes the part where you feel, I don't like, really don't like this set of vasanas. And I really need to improve on this. Okay, how do I readjust and retune myself? The vasanas rather. Okay, we can readjust. For readjusting, I need support. The support is scriptural study, prayers, meditation, japa, whatever you can do. Whatever feels closest to you. Deep practice of yogasana. And pranayama, anything that feels, oh, I can do this. I feel relaxed. Take it up. This is a support system to readjust those vasanas. Of course, surrender to the guru. And you know, speaking to the master, saying, I have these, what should I do? All this will help. See, the ultimate solution is exhaustion of vasanas by self-inquiry and self-realization. 100%. Everything will be like completely disassociated. Program is there and you are no longer bound to that subtle body. What is technically taking, you know, as we call it, birth every time? Who is dying? Who is taking birth? These vasanas, this program only is taking birth every time. The body cannot be reborn, right? It has to go back to the five elements and then reformat itself into something else. Nothing is destroyed for sure, but it is reformed into something else. Then now comes what takes birth then? Consciousness? No, consciousness is not born. Anadi, right? So it was beginningless, never born, never to die. Then who is born and who is dying? What is, you know, constantly changing forms? This bag, you know, this subtle body, you could say. Basically, the vasanas, the tendencies, these are attached to the bag of karma also. So all this together, this whole package is taking forms, different forms. Why? I have to finish these vasanas and I have to finish these karmas. That is why birth and death becomes a cycle. And this chapter deals with readjustment of this package. So this is in depth. You understand what is the reason for your sukha and dukkha today. What is causing you misery? This only. This karma package, this vasana package is causing us lot of misery. Why am I facing this? Why is my family like this? Why is my child like this? Why is my spouse like this? Why is my boss like this? Why is my body like this? Why do I have this disease? Etc. etc. Whatever is your misery or your greatest sukha today is all because of the vasana, the package. So wherever you want, Krishna is offering us a readjustment technique through this chapter. That's why it's most practical. Because what's making us suffer, there I can go and make small adjustments. See, it's not a permanent thing. It's not like if I make adjustment, I'll be self-realized. No. Honestly, no. But I can live a better life. I can live a better life. We all have this, you know, this life to experience, to live, to enjoy, to go through certain miseries, to learn certain lessons, to grow, to evolve. But how many of them are actually evolving? Very few. Most people are just living the program and finish. Then the program continues. That's why we say, na, agle hafte. The program continues. The serial always continues, right? The TV serials that we watch. And at the prime epitome moment, the peak moment, it will say, next Tuesday, next Wednesday, next Thursday. Continued. That's the life that we are leading. At the peak moment, what the desire was, next birth. Immediately, doesn't matter what it is, next birth. So the next birth, next life is based on that one peak desire at the time of death. Because that is so strong a vasana, it will format a body for itself to exhaust it. So understand, these are much in depth, okay? So now, where are we? How good are we with time? Some more time. Good, good. Yeah. Now, the same spirit, the same consciousness and the same matter, but expression is different. Each of you is expressed differently. Why? Because of the gunas. So understand these small pointers. Now, see, the Rajasthama Sattva, like the three dosha, you know, the pitta and the kapha and the vata, similarly, this Rajasthama Sattva in different proportions, each one of us have different proportions. And these proportions, you know, decide our intellectual ability, our emotional ability, everything. So today, if you feel that, oh, I can just by heart this chapter today, then understand that it is the play of the gunas, which is retuning or adjusting your ability. Today, I don't know, I'm feeling very dull. I can't learn one lesson also. Tamas, very high. And rajas, I can do five chapters, but I end up doing only one actually. It is like the hare and the tortoise story. You know, running full speed. Ah, I can do what this one can do. The tortoise is sattva, technically. We'll reach. We'll reach for sure. Right? Very, you know, balanced. So they will reach. So when there is too much rajas, there is a, you know, miscalculation. Overexcitement. Less things done. Tamas. I can't do anything. I will sit on the sofa. Couch potato. Very good. Sattva will not say anything. Things will be done in very short period of time. So you only check when you enter the kitchen, when you're cooking, when you're cleaning, when you're reading. Keep checking. Today, I didn't cross over 5 lines. I had to read 10 times here. Yesterday, I read the whole page. I understood. Why? You only, you are the person. There was no switch in the person, right? What switched? Gunas. The other day, late night, I was reading some book. And then I observed that earlier times, okay, earlier times, I was the night owl. 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, I could read, absorb, master, and do anything about it. But nowadays, if it is 10:30, 11, 11:30, I read and then I read and then I read and then I keep it because I don't understand anything. So that means tamas has dawned and I have to just go to sleep. It's a clear understanding that even if I read the whole night, I will not cross that one page. So better to sleep. So it's a switch. You observe yourself how much switches happen. Earlier, early morning, if I get up in school days, I couldn't read. I couldn't remember any of the answers. So 2 o'clock in the night, I will remember sleep and get up little late and go to my exam and I'll be doing good. But now if I have to give an exam, I have to get up in the morning and study. I can't do it at night. It's just a switch. It's not good or bad, right or wrong. Just observation of the switch of which guna is dominating when. And which guna is very, very, very down, very, very up, very, very good. Keep checking yourself. On different days, it will be different also. Different days, it will be different. Okay? So you don't know when your eureka moment will happen that, oh, I got this, you know. We don't know when it will happen. So keep experimenting. Doesn't matter. And it will be different proportions and very distinct it will be at different times. Be very clear. It will also define the gunas proportion that you have will define your conduct. You know, it will define your behavior, how you behave, your nature. Everything will be defined by these three gunas. After a while, you will start feeling, who am I? If everything is being done in matter by the gunas, consciousness is providing the light, who am I in this? Then the serious question will come. Then you will go back to chapter 13. But first, let's crack this, you know, very technical part of who we think we are. Now, next thing to understand, as I said, individually detect, observe, make a note, readjust. This is the practical work throughout the chapter. Okay? Now, see, understand that the subtle body is known as Antahkarana, which is inner instruments. Then we have the external Bahya Karana, eyes, nose, lips, all this, whatever, speech, tongue, etc., all the five. Action organs and the sense organs. This is technically bahya, external. Antaha, what is within? What is within us is the antaha, inner instruments. How to deal with these inner instruments? There is a memory, there is a intellect, there is a manaha, mind, and there is a ego. All these we have to deal with. Every moment we have to deal with this. And we don't know. Suppose in the kitchen, I have to fry puri. What will I use? Will I use a spatula, which I used to remove dosa? No. Now I have to cut, a big pumpkin, hard pumpkin. How about using a butter knife? Not possible, right? To cut the butter, which is very soft, I use the sharpest knife. Stupidity. This is what we are doing. We have the tools. We have the tools. Okay? But when we have to use emotions, we are using sharp knife. And where we are supposed to use the intellect to cut through the knowledge, we are using butter knife or spatula. This is where we are in distress. We have to learn which tool to use where. We are very smart in the kitchen now. We can tell our child, what are you using? Use that one for this. Don't use this for this. Okay. We are perfect in that. Now, our instruments, inner instruments, how will I use this? To use my inner instruments, I have to know which to use where. So for that, I need to know the functions of each of them. If I don't know what a sharp knife is doing, I will use it for anything. If I have only my intellect, when I have to hug a child, I will use my intellect. I have to use emotion. I have to scold the child. Not doing homework, not studying. Don't bring emotion. Use your intellect. What we do? Full blackmail. Indian mothers, especially. मैंने इतने साल गवाए तेरे पीछे. आई लेफ्ट माई जॉब. आई डिड सो मच फॉर यू. ओ माई गॉड, हू द चिल्ड्रन थिंक. क्या ड्रामा क्वीन है यार. शी शुड हैव बीन इन एन ओपरा रोल और इन ऑन अ स्टेज. व्हाट इज शी डूइंग इन द हाउस? लुक एट योर सेल्फ. टेल योर चिल्ड्रन दैट वेन यू आर इन सच. अर्लियर ओनली वॉर्न देम. टेल देम वेन आई गेट इन टू दिस, वन ऑफ यू स्टैंड एंड रिकॉर्ड इट फॉर मी, वीडियो रिकॉर्डिंग. And then look at yourself, what are you doing? What were you supposed to do? Sit down and study. It is the exam. Otherwise, you will fail and you will be disappointed. So take time and study and do this later on. Every time you're doing that, tears also will come. As if the saying was not enough. Anger will come, then tears will come, then guilt will come. Why do we even watch serials, actually? We can record every family drama and just circulate it. It is better than a serial because serial is boring, same characters every day. We record all the family dramas and just post it for everybody to have fun. For us also, just look at yourself. What are you doing in your life? Where there is emotion needed, bring emotion. Your child is sick. You have to be both practical and emotional at that time. So know that what tools I have to use where. It's very, very important. Don't mess up with this, okay? Be very, very smart and use the right thing in the right place. We'll learn how to use this, where to use, what to do. It is all based on the gunas. Like you have to catch a bus. You have to speed up. Yeah, the bus is just there. You have to speed up. You have to run. Or you have to be very clear. I will miss the bus and I will wait for 30 minutes. Then walk very calmly, which is fine. But you are neither running nor, you're frustrated. I missed the bus also. I couldn't run also. 30 minutes, all this is waste of your energy. What were you supposed to do? Either you run, and if you can't run, chalo. 30 minutes, I have time. Let me read something. Carry a book or, mobile also has PDFs. Stand or sit on the bus stop, wherever you are placed. Read 30 minutes time well spent. And nowadays, we are not much bothered now with WhatsApp and Instagram. Wherever 30 minutes, Insta. Like. Yeah. If a very kind advice I would say to all of you, All those who feel that you want to be really successful on any path, not only spiritual, any path in your life, please don't go on Instagram. Just deactivate the account. It's the most useless thing I've ever seen in my life. Most useless. You can continue the WhatsApp messaging and chatting. Keeps you connected with the world. It's okay. And how much time you can spend. It's okay. But Instagram, if you want to watch something and, you know, spend good time, even if you want to just watch a recipe, check the YouTube channels. There is better content there than on Instagram. Instagram is reel based, photo based. It's just wasting time and energy. Think about this. You don't have to take any step instantly. Think about this. Check how much time you wasted on Instagram throughout the day. And check, was it worth it? And what did you learn from that? Because I'm interacting with people, so generally I find a lot of this one-liner gurus nowadays. You know, we read one line and one quote and we are like, I'm realized today. Why? Instagram quote. I always say, whatever you find on Instagram, go to the source. Go to the source of the article and see what else that person said. Because see, one-liners are what? You pick the best of it and you flash it. Right? But andar, aur kya kya bola? And maybe the person said even better stuff supporting that one line. So then, suppose you went on Instagram and you liked something, go to the source of that entire article or entire talk and then go through it because it will be useful. This is my suggestion. If you still want to continue Instagram for good content, then always make sure that that one line has also got the link to the entire stuff. Lot of people, like two or three of you have sent me something, one-liners, and I liked it and I said, send me the source. Because I'm not on Instagram. So I had to open it on regular Google, that thing. And then I say, I liked it, send me the source. Because I want to listen to the whole thing. Because I want the proper content. If you want to consume something, consume the whole meal. Okay, all of you, let's go to Baskin. Now, in a simple way that you will understand, any ice cream parlor, whichever you natural shell, whichever you like, wherever they give the taster, only such parlors will visit, okay? The small spoon, you've seen, right? Okay, there are 50 flavors. You can taste and come out. No scoop given to you. Come out. Is it enough? Did you feel you ate anything? Did you feel satisfied? No. You taste two or three. Then what do you do? Give me that double scoop. Sit down. Enjoy that whole thing. This is what we are doing with Instagram. Tasters. And then junk food ho gaya na? Then it is only junk. There is no meal. There is only the taster. So be careful of this. Why? Because these things are creating impressions on that subtle body, in our chitta. And what Yoga Sutra said, Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodha. How will the vritti go? How will the vritti subside? The modifications? If constantly I am feeding ding, 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 small, 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 small food. Instead, I give the right food to the chitta for purification. Just like physically we are concerned with what I eat, what my mind eats is also my concern. In fact, physically what I eat could be my mom's concern or my cook's concern, but what my mind eats is my concern. See, right now your mind is consuming something when I'm speaking. It is consuming the knowledge of the 14th chapter, the understanding of the subtle body, how to, you know, understand and deal with it, readjust. This is consumption. So you should choose what to consume. Is it worth it? Is it helping? Is it, you know, promoting the purification of my chitta, of my antakarana? Chitta is antakarana. So this is very, very important. Okay, so now let's see what is left out because we are almost time up. Okay, another way to understand the gunas is the gears in the car. Okay, like first gear, second gear, third gear, whatever gears, and neutral. There is a neutral gear. Not automatic cars, we are speaking of gear wala gadi. So all the cars that have these gears have first gear, second gear, third gear, fourth gear, maybe I don't know how many gears are there nowadays, maybe five. And there is a neutral always. So to go from one gear to another, you each time have to go back to neutral. This neutral is important. Understand this neutral. Okay, the balance. The sattva. Rajastamas sattva. Rajastamas sattva. Each time you pull the neutral, understand that you're balancing things. So understand it like that. Okay? Imagine that the subtle body is like a car. Okay? And the engine is going haywire, spitting fire here and there. Something went wrong. Rajas. Over Rajas. Okay, Gadi, the car is not starting trouble, tamas. The vehicle is functioning smoothly, sattva. Understand the body, the mind and the entire composition with the help of rajas, tamas and sattva. Through this chapter we will learn. Okay, today we have not technically taken any shloka. But next time we'll take at least three shlokas. Understand that there are only 27 shlokas in this chapter. So it's a small one, but a practical one. Okay? So think about this. And if you have time, we have 1 week, right, for the next session. Go through the chapter translations and, you know, try to understand as much as you can. It's 27 shlokas. It will take you like maybe 5 to 6 minutes to go through the translation. Just go through, just like that, every day. 5 minutes, just go through the translations. Okay? And everybody keep the Gita as a handbook, as a guide. Okay, and when you're in trouble or messed up, just open it and open any page and just read the shloka on that page. And something will change within you for sure. Try this and let me know. So let's close.
Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Chalo, thank you so much. Stay blessed. Bye-bye.